Hey, what's up? This is Jerry with WealthX. Hope you're doing well today. I want to give you a real quick video on today's economy, what it looks like, what it's all about, what we can do about it. Before I do that, as always, I need to introduce myself. So, as I said, I'm Jerry. I own a company called WealthX, and WealthX exists for one reason, and that reason is to help you own your potential. The reason why is because right now you're trading time for money. You're basically in financial prison. You don't see what you're capable of. You don't love what you do. And so because of that, you spend your whole life just doing that 9-to-5 rat race. I believe that's a shame. Hannah, thanks for watching. Hey, go ahead and like and share this. I want to talk to you guys today about the economy. My personal belief on the economy right now, if you look at it, it's doing awesome, right? You know, interest rates are fairly decent. The stock market's been ripping. Everything's been doing great. We look like we've recovered. Those are all of the symptoms that we can see. But I'm here to tell you that that's actually false. All of that is not correct, and I'm gonna dive into why. So you have to understand what an economy is. An economy is something that you can have on a large scale with a country, you can have on a small scale with a city, a state, a borough, whatever it is you have, a county. You can have it on a personal level in your household, and it's essentially the movement of goods, services, money, all of those different things. Hey, I love the likes, keep those going. But I want to talk to you about the national economy and also your personal economy. So I'm going to rewind a little bit, okay? I'm going to rewind to a time. I was actually in 10th grade when this went down, okay? 2008. I was in 10th grade. I remember coming home from school. My mom had the news on. They were talking about how the stock market had just tanked. We live in Alaska, so everyone was talking about how Obama was a terrorist and that it's all his fault, which is neither here nor there. But that's what was going on at the time. And so our federal government's solution to that was to start aggressively printing money. Okay, this is called quantitative easing. Quantitative easing is when the Federal Reserve basically influxes money into an economic environment in order to hopefully get a boost on spending, to prevent the money pool from drying up, to incentivize people to go out there and still buy and sell goods and enhance an economy that is either plummeting or failing or in a recession. So right now, when we look at the market, the one thing that I don't hear people talking about is quantitative easing. So if you look at the stock market since 2008, it's been ramping up. Like year after year, we've been hitting all-time high after all-time high. And it's really easy to get caught up in that and excited about it. But I was looking at a chart the other day, and this chart showed the PE ratio, the price earnings ratio of large stocks in our country in relation to the gross domestic product, the actual gross domestic product, the sales of the United States as measured by our federal government. And those ratios were extremely out of whack. What the chart was showing was that the PE ratios were extremely high, and there was no correlation between those and GDP. Now, there's only two other times that it was this high, and we actually beat this chart for 2016, 2017 actually beat both of those other times. So the last time it was that high, excuse me, it's three times, was 2008, 2001, and also the Great Depression. And we're higher, the ratios are higher than they were during those times. So here's the deal. When the federal government did what I just mentioned, quantitative easing, approximately $32,000 per second were printed and distributed into the economy. And then on top of that, they suppressed interest rates. They kept them low so that people would borrow money, so that people would buy homes, so that things could start to recover. And I know that I'm probably kind of nerding out here, but what I'm getting into is the numbers that you're seeing when you're looking at your home prices, when you're looking at your 401ks, when you're looking at interest rates, all the numbers that you're seeing that look good are still just after effects of what happened in 2008. We never fixed the issue. We never fixed the problem. We just printed more money. We pulled the interest rates down. We made it to where everything felt good, fine, and dandy so that people would continue to exchange money for products and services. That's called monetary velocity. We talked about that a few weeks ago. And so the effect of that is our economy looks great, and it really isn't. There are not numbers that back up where the economy is at now. So if you look at all of the indicators, I just mentioned that chart, GDP and PE ratio is a great way to look at it. When you look at that indicator, they're not on track. The correlation's not there. So all of that to say, none of that matters. I talk to business owners all the time, and whether you're looking at a global economy, a country's economy, a state's economy, we blame the economy all the time. I hear it almost every day. You know, I talked to a sales guy just last week and he said, oh yeah, the economy in my city is tough. And so because of that, my sales aren't doing well. My income's not where it needs to be at. And so I want to acknowledge and validate, yes, it's a problem. But I want to say it's a bigger problem than you even know about. We're talking about like basically bloated stock market numbers, fake interest rates, all of this stuff that you probably haven't even considered. It's way worse than you think. But that being said, you are responsible for your personal economy. Just because we have irresponsible government officials, just because our country is run by a private bank called the Federal Reserve, just because there's all of this manipulation going on economically, does not mean that you're not in control of your economy. So what is your economy? Your economy is the network that you're building, the exchanges you're making, the income you're bringing in, the money that you're spending. Those are all things that you can control. You can't control what they do in Washington. You can't control what they do at the Federal Reserve. You can't control what Wall Street decides to do. And so I want to give you some pointers, some things that you can do. I believe we're currently in a recession. I don't think that most people realize that or feel it. I think it's going to catch up and it's going to start to be something everyone realizes and starts to feel, and it's going to be too late by the time it gets there. If you're trying to fight a recession during the recession, you waited too long. Okay, that's just my word of advice. So the things you can actually do, how can you take charge? How can you make sure you're going to be okay? One, you can make sure that you are not investing in fake things. If numbers are inflated, if numbers are fake, don't invest in them. Don't invest in things that are overinflated that you can't track and say, this is why it went up. That's why I personally like real estate. A great place to be, cash. If you're unsure, just have money in the bank. You don't need to go buy something. You don't need to go invest. My number one rule for my clients is never invest in something that doesn't make sense to you. So if you're looking at the economy and saying it doesn't make sense to me, don't invest in it. You can sit on the sideline and wait for things to pan out and see what happens. There's no reason you have to make a play, okay? The second thing, don't go buy crap you don't need. The number one reason people get hit so hard during recessions is because prior to the recession, they buy junk. They go buy a $6,000 couch and they finance it on 60 months at 0%. They go get a brand new car. They say, hey, my real estate's up. I'm going to put my $20,000 that I've been saving into a down payment. Don't do that either. Do not buy crap you don't need. Crap you don't need is things that are classified under the category of does not produce income. If it does not produce income, don't buy it. Okay? Restrict, economize, pull back. When things are up, you need to be opposite. You need to go in reverse of the trend. Okay? So that's the first thing. The second thing, like I said, be in cash. Be in cash, just wait. You don't have to jump into it. If you're in the valley like Mitch is, don't jump into income properties right now. Wait for them to come down. A lot of it is overpriced. Thanks for watching, by the way, Mitch. Hey, go ahead and share this if people around you need to know this information. The third thing, you need to be getting out and connecting with people, especially if you're in business, especially if you're in sales. Whether they're a buyer or a client or not, you need to be connecting with people, because when a recession happens, it's the people you know and the people that know you that are going to help each other out. If you're sitting in your high tower and you're not going out into the community and connecting with people and telling them about what you do, finding out what they do, trying to exchange value, then when a recession happens, their tides are going to rise because they're going to network with each other and they're going to be okay, and you're going to be left out of that circle. Okay, so those are three things you can practically do. The fourth thing is get educated. This is the final thing, get educated. It's fourth, but really it's first. It's the number one thing you need to do. You need to get educated. Understand, even at a very simple level, how our economy works. Understand interest rates. Understand monetary policy. Understand central banking. Understand stock markets. You don't need to go get a college degree. You can go look online. You can read books. You can find credible sources. You need to understand. You need to learn. Skill up as well. So part of that learning is making sure that whatever you do, you're not only the best at it, but you're the best at making people know about it. Okay, so if you're a painter, you can't just be a good painter and say, oh, my work will speak for itself. Paintings don't talk. That's a figure of speech. It doesn't actually work. It's actually a cop-out. It's something that people use to avoid doing something uncomfortable. If you're good at something, you need to make sure, yes, you are good at it, and then you need to make sure that tons of people know about it. Okay. And part of that is knowing how to communicate, knowing how to ask questions, knowing how to present what you do, knowing how to sell your ideas, knowing how to persuade people to your side, knowing how to arrange and negotiate agreements that create win-win scenarios. And that is the first and foremost thing you need to focus on. Go learn, go study, go get educated. Stay in cash if you're unsure. Don't buy into all of this bloated fake stuff in the markets. Don't buy into all of the bloated real estate numbers. None of that is going to help you. I hope that helps. Hey, I'm going to go ahead and sign off. If this was helpful for you, please share it. My mission in life is to help and empower millions of leaders to own their God-given ultimate potential. And I do that through you guys every day. Whenever you share my videos, whenever people see something and it helps them and they start watching and sharing as well, that's how I grow. I hope to create more exchanges of value like this down the road as we continue to go on with our relationship. Have a great Tuesday, I think it is. Maybe it's Wednesday. I don't know what day it is. Have a great whatever day it is. I'm going to sign off. I'll talk to you guys next time.